Hello, and welcome to the Scriptures Are Real podcast. This is the podcast where we talk about elements of the Scriptures that have helped them become more real to us because we believe that helps us draw more power out of them, and we need all the help we can get. I'm your host, Kerry Muelstein, and it's nice to have back in the saddle with me again. A familiar figure to the longtime listeners of the podcast, this is Dr. Andrew Skinner. Welcome back, Andy.
Thank you so much. Wonderful to be with you.
I think it was only a few weeks ago that we were introducing Revelation. So maybe about a month and a half ago, something like that, we were introducing the book of Revelation to everyone. So just good to have you with us again.
Thank you so much.
So I'm so happy to announce our workshops that we did at Book of Mormon workshops in December were so popular, and I've had so many people have asked if we'd please do more, including people who were there asked if we'd do more. So we're going to do another Book of Mormon workshop on March 1st and 2nd. We're still determining the venue. It'll be somewhere in Utah County and the Provo-Orem area, something along those lines, Lehi, American Fork. And we're going to talk about some of the key elements and speeches and sermons of the Book of Mormon. It's going to be a lot of fun. So we'll get prices out to you soon and more details. For now, you can either email thescripturesareal@gmail.com or go to TSAR, that's T-S-A-R dot website, or patreon.com/enlightenedge.edu. That's the place where you can start to register and find out details as they come out. So start to look for this. And I think we'll have a Zoom component, but also that in-person component is so wonderful and so fun. And we hope that you'll join us for that. It's going to be really great stuff. We had a wonderful time doing it last time. So one thing that we need a segment of our audience to know is that Google has decided they're going to end Google Podcasts. So by March, there will be no more Google Podcasts. So if that's how you listen to our podcast, then you're just going to have to find another platform. We can't do anything about it. So you could try, you know, the Apple Podcast or Spotify or Amazon and so on. There are plenty of YouTube. We're on all those RSS.com. We're on all of those normal platforms. So by the beginning of March, I am sad to say you'll just have to migrate somewhere else. But I wanted to make sure you knew. I don't know if Google Podcast is letting everyone who listens to it know. So I wanted to make sure that you knew. I'm very pleased that we're going to be able to finally respond to a request that I've had a number of times from some of my different listeners or audience members. And that is to try and release our podcasts earlier. This is important, especially for people who are seminary teachers or early morning seminary teachers or gospel doctrine teachers, and they'd like the content a little bit earlier. It's a problem for various reasons to do that on the normal format, but we are trying to release them a few days earlier. So like on Thursday beforehand on our new website, that's tsar.website. So T-S-A-R for the Scriptures Are Real, tsar.website or patreon.com/enlightenedge.edu. You can start to get our episodes of our podcast earlier, and hopefully that's helpful for those who really need that extra prep time. So I'd like to remind you that we've been asked by some of the leadership in the church to make our podcast have more of an interactive element where you can share your insights with others and start to interact with each other about your scripture study and what you're pulling out of the scriptures and what you're getting from podcasts like ours or other sources that help you get more out of the scriptures. But especially we want to draw stuff out of the scriptures. So please either comment on YouTube or email us at thescripturesareal@gmail.com. or join our website where I've started some conversations and we're going to continue to start conversations where sometimes I'll ask questions. Please join us for these conversations. Share the insights that you're having. Ask questions. It's going to be a great exchange. Thank you. We have introduced Dr. Skinner many times, but let me just briefly tell a little bit more about him, or not more, but the same kinds of things for those who might be new to the podcast. I'm hoping we're getting some new people for this Book of Mormon year. And so Dr. Skinner, he's been the department chair of ancient scripture, dean of religious education. He has been the director of farms in the Maxwell Institute as they transitioned there. He's been a director or associate director at the BYU Jerusalem Center, has taught there numerous times. I've been a fan of his from when I was just a young pup, but I'd say when I really felt like we became brothers when we were teaching in Jerusalem together. And I knew before that he was both an amazing scholar and just an amazing person, but I really came to know it there. So I'm so grateful that you're you're with us, and you've been able to tell about yourself before, but is there anything else you'd like to say?
About 10% of what you said is true, but I'm very grateful for your kindness, and it means a lot to me to have your friendship. I'm reminded of something that President Faust, James E. Faust, used to say of the first presidency. He was getting some kind of an award one time, an exemplary manhood award or something, and he stood up and said, "I really don't deserve this, but about a month ago I got the flu and I didn't deserve that either, so I'll just take the compliment."
That's great. Okay. Well, good. And I mean, I'm pretty sure you just called me a liar, but that's okay. I'll be all right. I'm just teasing. Okay. Well, we have a huge reading assignment this week, and just more in it than we could ever possibly cover, including Isaiah chapters and so on. And I'll put some things about that on my new little website for people to help them as well. We're just going to do what we can do, and we'll enjoy it while we do it. So, Dr. Skinner, why don't you take us to where some of this has become real and powerful for you?
Well, first of all, let me say that I think that 1 Nephi chapters 16 through 22 is a section that is for us a scriptural treasure. I think it's significance lies in its value to both the ancients and to us moderns. The ancients, because it is a wonderful messianic prophecy. It holds the promise of the scattering, but yet the gathering and restoration of Israel. And for us, a tremendous value, because it prophesies about this last dispensation and teaches us some powerful lessons, not only about what we can expect to happen and what has happened in this last dispensation, but also what will happen in the future. I think this section of 16 through 22 is so good because Laman and Lemuel are so bad. If I could use that terminology, as a result of Laman and Lemuel's constant disobedience and rebellion, we receive and understand one of the great unheralded prophecies of the latter days, information about the first coming of the Messiah. And interestingly enough, we receive a prophetic portrait of a prophet, the prophet of the last days, the prophet Joseph Smith, in the writings of one of the greatest ancient prophets to have ever lived. That's Isaiah, obviously. Isaiah spoke about the first and second comings of the Messiah, as we know. He spoke about the last days. He spoke about the restoration of Israel. But embedded in chapters 48 and 49 is a prophecy, a sort of a portrait and prophecy of one who would be a great leader and a restorer to the house of Israel. And that's none other than the prophet Joseph Smith. So that's
and maybe I can just interrupt to say that's Isaiah 48 and 49, which is 1 Nephi 20 and 21.
So. Exactly. So I think we'll try to quote from the Book of Mormon presentation of Isaiah, but they're virtually so close that you could go to either one.
Yeah, I agree. I just didn't want our audience to be confused when they heard 48 and 49 and started looking for 1 Nephi chapter 48. But
Sorry about that.
No, it's good. We want to highlight that this is really right out of Isaiah.
And that's what Nephi is doing, is he's quoting Isaiah to his brothers because what Isaiah has to say applies to their situation so well. Isaiah is chastising Israel. Nephi has tried for a very long time to persuade his brethren to behave themselves, to believe in the coming of the Messiah, to believe in the validity of dad's prophecies, his revelation, but to no avail. So this section in 1 Nephi opens in the old world, in the valley of Lemuel, against the backdrop of Laman and Lemuel's stubborn and rebellious attitudes. And it's good to remember that Nephi has just seen the vision that his father Lehi has seen. And he finds his brothers arguing about what father Lehi has been trying to teach them. And of course, in chapter 15, we see Nephi engaging them and asking why they're arguing about the teachings of Father Lehi. And Nephi finds out that they just don't understand. And they've made no effort really to understand. They haven't petitioned the Lord. They haven't gone to the Lord. And they haven't been faithful in keeping the commandments, as Nephi emphasizes. And Nephi teaches them in chapter 15, actually, a lead up to chapter 16, several things that the symbolism behind the olive tree that his father spoke of has to be understood in the context ultimately of the last days, or the latter days, or the times that we live in, that the fullness of the gospel would come to their posterity, that is the posterity of Lehi, Nephi, Laman, and Lemuel, through the Gentiles, and that their posterity will be remembered among the house of Israel, even though they're a branch separated from the main trunk of Israel. And that the gospel would not come to the posterity of Lehi, Nephi, Laman, Lemuel, and so on until after they had been scattered by the Gentiles. And so Nephi says that he thus spoke to his brothers of the latter-day restoration by rehearsing to them the words of Isaiah. And that is a great lead-in to chapter 16, where we want to really focus our attention, 16 and following, because chapter 16, as we all know, opens with more protests from his brothers, and Nephi is acknowledging that he has spoken hard things to them, things that are difficult to understand, but it's hard because the guilty take the truth to be hard. And this then produces something surprising, which I think first-time readers may not expect, but it is, in fact, that Laman and Lemuel, on this occasion, as chapter 16 opens, these brothers did humble themselves in so much that Nephi says that he has great joy and great hope for his brother's reformation. This is 1 Nephi chapter 16, verse 5. And so we begin on a positive note after several negative things.
And I think there's a great lesson to be learned here, if it's all right to just interrupt for a second. But one day, I don't know, I keep thinking that this is a study I'll do, and I probably never will. So someone else should do this study. I think it's worth a really intense, in-depth look. But I think there's something to be gained from contrasting Laman and Lemuel and Alma the Younger, because they both have angels come and reprimand them. They're both humbled when the angel reprimands them. But Laman and Lemuel, just, it doesn't stick. And they keep going through this. This is our, probably, I think, at least second, maybe third time, that it kind of depends on how you take some things, that they're humbled, that they seem to be ready to do things right. And we're going to see some more after this, as they're shocked later, as they're on the ship and so on and so on. They keep getting humbled, but it just doesn't stick. Whereas with Alma, he has that one time and it sticks, right? And I think probably the key difference is that with Alma, the younger, you'll find him very soon after he's had this experience with the angel. When he talks about his change, he doesn't say that he knows because an angel came and told him. He talks about the experience of the angel making him think, but he says he knows because he has fasted and prayed much to know, right? He doesn't just have that temporary change. He then engages in the things that will make it a meaningful and lasting change that helps him really know. Whereas Laman and Lemuel keep having these great big experiences, and they don't pay the price, as you just mentioned. They don't then go inquire of the Lord. It doesn't stick.
The fruits of the two, I think, are dependent on what they do, as you say, with their budding faith.
Yes,
and that would be an interesting study. But I think you're exactly right, and we see many, many examples of that, not just in the Book of Mormon, but in our own day,
yeah,
and even in our own families. And that's one of the reasons why I think that this is such an important section in the Book of Mormon, because we learn some lessons, I think, about the way families operate. Even righteous families have challenges, and we want to learn what we can from Lehi and Sariah, who had no easy time of it, considering how they raised their family in difficult circumstances.
Yes, as you say that, I'm a phrase or a challenge from President Nelson that he gave both to the young single adults and then to the entire church comes to mind. I think we see early in the early chapters of First Nephi, this contrast where Nephi takes charge of his testimony and Laman and Lemuel don't. Yeah. And Alma took charge of his testimony and Laman and Lemuel don't, right? So maybe that's a way of tying that into a modern prophetic teaching, that what we need to do is those things that Nephi did, asking, studying, that Alma did, fasting, praying, studying, that help us take charge of our testimony. That's where, because I've been Laman and Lemuel, where I've had a great experience and then I don't follow through, and that was that. Anyway, so hopefully we can all take charge of our testimony.
Well, for me, it reemphasizes, not to belabor the point, but it reemphasizes the point that faith is an action word. Yeah. Miracles, visitation of angels, powerful experiences don't create faith, but those kinds of things do strengthen faith after the individual has put forth some effort. So faith is an action word, period, exclamation point, and these are great examples of that particular principle.
Amen.
It's interesting to me in chapter 16 that Nephi spends only one verse explaining that that he and his brothers got married, which I suppose we don't need to know all of the details about that. But what really does fascinate me is that immediately following Nephi's fairly innocuous statement, we got married and began our own families, is what follows. And the quote that I'm interested in is, "And thus my father had fulfilled all the commandments of the Lord, which had been given unto him," unquote. It's almost like Nephi is saying one of the commandments that Lehi was charged with was to make sure that his family were safely married.
Yeah.
In this wilderness. And I wondered about that. I suppose that we don't need to belabor the point, but it is an interesting juxtaposition. We got married, and thus my father fulfilled all of the commandments that the Lord had given him. Okay. Well, what's the application for us? I'm not sure exactly, but I think that there is something that we ought to learn from that. Part of the responsibility of parenthood is to continue to be concerned for the welfare of your children. And boy, you have seen this. I've seen this. Many, many people have seen this. Little children, little problems. Big people, big problems.
Yeah, yeah.
And so I guess the lesson is you're never done being a parent.
Yeah. Oh, isn't that the truth? Or a grandparent or a great grandparent. Yeah.
Wow. Wow.
So again, if it's all right to pause for a second, on that thought you have, and if we're going to try and make this real and kind of put ourselves in Nephi and Lehi's position, Nephi is told when they're leaving that he'll be given a different promised land. Lehi and Nephi are told they have to leave where they're at. But they're not given the whole picture to begin with. They're not told at the beginning, well, you're going to go across these great waters, you're going to come over to this other continent, and you're going to have these other things happen, right? Instead, they're told to leave, that God will give them a promised land. Then they're told to go back and get the plates. Then they're told back to go back and get Ishmael's family. And I'm just going to assume, based on this comment that you're saying there, that somewhere in there, Lehi is told, yeah, and that's because they need to have wives, and this will allow them to have wives and perpetuate things and so on. So you can almost picture the family at that verse 8 spot in chapter 16 saying, we've done everything, right? Everything God has asked us to do, all of the instructions, all of the promptings that Lehi has been given, or dreams, instructions and dreams and everything else, it's happened at this point. They've done every single thing God did ask them to do. And they may be thinking, all right, well, this is where we're at. This is where is this our new life? Is this where we stay? Is this our promised land? Is this the end of that journey? And so on. And so I think it's not a coincidence that the next thing that happens is they get away to learn more. But I can picture them saying, because it's so often the case with us, I think, in our lives, that we get inspiration and we do it and we're like, okay, we're done. When really that inspiration was to get you to the place where God can give you a left-hand turn and tell you now is the next thing that you're going to do. You just needed to get here so you could do that.
And it strikes me that that's one of the tremendous values of the Book of Mormon. It's really a primer on how to be a good child and how to be a good parent. And I wish we could see a little bit more of that in our instruction on Sunday and in the things that we talk about on a regular basis. Because even though we learn that Lehi is after the children are married, even though Lehi says that he's done everything that, or Nephi says that he's done everything that the Lord commanded him, it still does not prevent Lehi from falling into the trap that he's seen his older sons fall into, and that is complain when things get tough. You know, when after Nephi breaks his bow in the wilderness, Laman and Lemuel are mad at him. Why they would be mad and why they didn't, you know, decide to do something about it themselves, we're not told, but
mad at themselves for their own bow problems. But
exactly. Yeah. And then we're told even Lehi, who is this towering figure of strength and faith and hope moving forward, not being told beforehand, but just being told to move forward and being nudged by the Holy Spirit, even he falls into this trap of murmuring. And so I guess there's a good lesson for all of us is that righteousness, and we certainly have to say that Nephi and Lehi are righteous, righteousness doesn't mean that you're not going to have problems, and it doesn't mean that Lucifer isn't going to work on you harder, and you might stumble and fall a time or two. And rather than beat ourselves up, let's gird up our loins and just press forward and repent and get on with it. So
beautiful. And, anyway. and I keep waylaying us. We may not get very far, but I've just remembered something that I should have remembered earlier and even talked to you about, that I've been asked as we go along to try and teach scripture study skills as we do this. And so I think maybe one of them we could put in is what you did with verse 8, which is where it says, and thus my father had commilled. I would say, especially in the Book of Mormon, more than anywhere else, if our readers will pay attention every time you see and thus, or to stop and think.
And thus we see.
Yeah.
In fact, one of our colleagues, long since retired, wrote a whole book about that phrase, and thus we see. It's a signal for us to pay close attention because there are important lessons to be learned. So that is a great study skill. Another great study skill, which we'll get to momentarily in chapter 19, is what Nephi thinks considers the most valuable interpretive tool when studying scriptures, and that is likening the scriptures unto ourselves.
Yeah,
we see this over and over again in these ancient biblical communities as well as the Book of Mormon. I want to just hold that in abeyance because a couple of other things I want to say about that.
Yeah, sounds good.
So Lehi is then commanded to journey in the wilderness. He's given a navigation instrument at this point. It's the first time I think we're introduced to this navigation instrument, an instrument, as we're told, of curious workmanship. And we learn some important things about this Liahona or Liahona, in chapter 16, verses 28 and 29. Number one, we learn that it operates by faith and obedience. Secondly, it's as an example to us of how great things come about by small means. It's a very small instrument, and yet it is so incredibly valuable to Lehi and his family. We don't immediately learn the word, the name of this instrument. That comes later on, but it comes in a section which is maybe the most valuable application to our own lives about the Liahona in Alma chapter 37, verses 43 through 46. And what we learn there is that the Liahona is a type and a shadow of Jesus Christ. And the question then is raised, what are our personal small and simple things, or what are our personal pointers or directional finders that help us through life? Clearly, the Liahona was that to Lehi's family, but what are ours? I haven't discovered an actual Liahona, but I have discovered some things in my life that are direction pointers that help me find my way. And I know that some people say, yeah, you're going to say the same old things, like faith in Jesus Christ, like daily prayer, like daily scripture study, particularly daily reading the Book of Mormon, praying for charity. Boy, if there's one thing that I would say can change the course of our lives, it's praying for an increase in charity, cultivating patience, cultivating meekness, and all those sorts of things. But I think all of us want to know how we can find those pointers, those directional means that will keep us headed in the right direction, the ultimate destiny being eternal life. And this is a point worth studying on a personal basis. This chapter 16 plus Alma chapter 37, we look to Christ and are guided just as the Lehites looked to this instrument to be guided. Christ points the way. And we're back to modern prophets. President Nelson, Christ is always the answer. Well, that sounds, perhaps it sounds trite to some people, but the more we study what are the directional finders in our lives, the more we realize Jesus Christ really is the answer for everything. Amen. So section that I really think is important, not for us to pontificate about, but to encourage all of us to really look at this section.
Amen to that. And I'm with you. I would encourage everyone to get back into the scriptures, study those two chapters in conjunction with each other. And maybe I'll just throw in one other way that, at least for me, the Liahona or Liahona is much, it's a lot like the Holy Ghost, right? If you want direction in life, it seems like Nephi is saying, if we didn't believe it would direct us, or if it directed us, but we didn't follow the directions, then it didn't keep working. Mm-hmm. And I think the promptings of the Spirit are very similar. If you believe God is going to be speaking to you and giving you direction, you're probably going to get some direction. And then if you follow that direction, you're going to get more. If you don't, well, President Hunter once said, if you fail to follow the promptings of the Spirit, those promptings will cease. But I suspect the converse is true. If you give diligence to the promptings of the Spirit, they will increase. I think that that's one of the great keys for me is, am I getting some little directions from the Spirit and am I acting on them? Then I know I'm going on the right path. And I think it does happen more and more and more, the more and more and more you act on it. Probably President Monson is the best example of that any of us can think of. But I think that's another way we can think of as you said, there are so many ways, and everyone should give real thought to it for themselves and study this for themselves. But that's one I think it's worth considering.
It's, I guess there's an analogy that comes to my mind, and that's the idea of muscle memory. You do something for so long that it not only becomes easier, but you become more skilled at it.
Yeah.
And that's true for scripture study, for paying attention to the promptings of the Holy Spirit, for not being a spiritual blabbermouth, not bragging or boasting in the ways that the Lord helps you personally. All of that, the more you do it, the easier it becomes, the stronger you become, and it's a great promise that is held out to us.
Amen to that.
Yeah, we're not zipping through this, are we?
No, I'm sorry, but that's good. We're happy to deep dive, but I am sorry, I keep waylaying you.
No. That's I think what you say is very, very helpful in articulating what I meant to say. So, as we have said before, Laman and Lemuel, and even infecting Ishmael's posterity, again, keep murmuring. Their anger level must be super high at this point. Their dissatisfaction, if we can use that benign term, becomes so intense that they even start to think about murdering their father and their brother. So I'm going to go out on a limb and say that these are now corrupted people. They've lived in a, I think, one of the best environments, family environments they could have lived in. They have seen powerful spiritual manifestations. They've had correction offered to them, and they've had explanation given to them. And yet they seem to be spiraling down in a more accelerated way. And this is not Nephi's fault. It's not anything that the parents have done. In fact, the parents have done everything that they can. And so I would suggest that when we're tempted to beat ourselves up and we have children that we think are not following the right path, that we not blame ourselves for this. Yeah. I'm not saying we shouldn't keep trying, but I am saying that it's the myth of the perfect family, I guess. Yeah. I'm not sure that there are perfect families, that we approach perfection as we invest our time and our thoughts and our actions in Jesus Christ. But people go bad.
Yeah. Yeah. And then people can change later as well. So as you said, we want to have hope, but there's too much beating ourselves up for what other people do. And that's not helpful.
So life goes on. You're in the wilderness. They're following, I think, they travel in a southeast direction. They stop to bury Ishmael. At a certain point, they turn east. Perhaps the Arabian Peninsula is involved here.
And I'll just say, so that you know, and so that our audience knows, that Kent Brown, a couple days ago, did a lecture for the Society for the Preservation of Ancient Religious Cultures on this path, but we're just going to release that as an episode for this week as well. So you know how Kent Brown details out, well, okay, we think that it may have been this spot, and then they turn east. So people can get all sorts of details from our wonderful, wonderful colleague by listening to that.
Well, and just as an example of this not being far-fetched speculation, I have a little note that says in 1763, there was an expedition that was carried out for King Frederick V of Denmark, and they discovered a place called Nam, which may be Nahum, we don't know. But they place it 25 miles north of the village or the town of Sana. So there have been previous expeditions and previous discoveries. so that what Kent Brown says, he's not just flying by the seat of his pants, but there's historical reasons to suppose what he does.
And, I just sorry, keep going.
No, go ahead.
I just saw a headline for an article, and so I probably shouldn't bring this up because I have no idea how good it is. It was by someone who I think is usually pretty good, but I have no idea if there's anything solid to it or not. But it's worth looking into an article where someone said that they had found there in that place, the Nechum place, a marker for a grave with the name Ishmael on it. So I don't know. I mean, there are probably lots of Ishmaels as well, but I don't know what to make of that. I haven't looked into it yet, but I guess if people are looking for extra reading material, they could probably Google something along those lines and find that and decide for themselves whether there's good scholarship behind that there or not. I can't verify it myself right now, but interesting.
Well, thanks for the notification. We'll take a look at that. Chapter 17 begins with a significant lesson on the nature of afflictions and God's promises. It's summarized, I think, really, really well in verse 3 of chapter 17, keeping in mind, you know, that when Nephi breaks his bow, that means loss of food. They're eating raw meat. Bearing children in the wilderness. They are undoubtedly aware of predators, bandits in the region, which will affect the way they live life as they move their way through the wilderness. But it's one of those thus we see passages that you were mentioning. Mm-hmm. Verse 3 of chapter 17, and thus we see that the commandments of God must be fulfilled. And if it so be that the children of men keep the commandments of God, he doth nourish them and strengthen them and provide means whereby they can accomplish the thing which he has commanded them. Wherefore, he did provide means for us while we did sojourn in the wilderness. And I guess the lesson for me is, because I'm striving to be the kind of person God wants me to be, it doesn't mean that I'm not going to have challenging times. It does not mean that I'm going to be shielded from the normal ups and downs of this fallen world. But what it does mean is that God will strengthen me. God will provide a way for me to follow through on the things that he has asked me to do. So we're going to face challenges. I don't know why some people seem to face more challenges than others, but
yeah,
nevertheless, we do have the promise that our Father in heaven and his Son will strengthen our efforts so that we can come off conqueror in whatever challenges or difficulties we face. I really like chapter 17, verse 3. So thank you for letting me mention that.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'd say maybe there's another one of those words we should look for. And part of this is because when God or Nephi is telling us why something happens, we should pay attention, because most of the time we don't get the whys. We just get the whats. And so the thus is another word, and wherefores. For me, at any time I see a wherefore, it means stop and look at it. What's the relationship between the thing that comes before the wherefore and the after the wherefore that Nephi or whoever the author is trying to teach us? If you see a wherefore, there's someone who's trying to teach you the relationship between some things and the whys of that. And so I would pay attention to those words.
Thank you. I think that's an important comment. In chapter 17, we begin to notice interesting parallels between Nephi's circumstances, the ancient Israelite exodus, and our own journey along the covenant path. We have already mentioned the intense murmuring, the rebellion on the part of members of Lehi's family, the book of Exodus, which describes the ancient Israelite journey from Egypt, details the children of Israel murmuring against Moses, and pretty intensely at times. Exodus chapter 16, verse 2, Exodus 17, verse 3. Mm-hmm. Much of this related to circumstances that they didn't like because it forced them to act, to do something, where they had not a great life maybe, but a cushiony life, and they knew what was coming. They could expect what the next day was going to be like, and this is not what happens when you're told by God to journey in the wilderness. You have to exercise faith to move forward, not knowing beforehand, and that puts us sometimes in an uncomfortable position. So there's that parallel. Also, we notice in chapter 17, Israel's journeying in their wilderness towards the promised land involved the Lord's hand. The Lord was with them in their journey, just like he was with, or is with at this point, Lehi's family. So there's that interesting parallel between the ancient Israelite Exodus and Lehi's family journeying in their wilderness. We also note the pattern of a prophet leader receiving revelation on a mountaintop. Mm-hmm. That happens among the Israelites, Exodus chapter 19, but it also happens with Nephi's family. Nephi in chapter 18, verse 3 says, you know, I went to the mountain often and received many things of the Lord. So I think that that's an interesting parallel between the Israelite Exodus and the Lehite Exodus in their journey. And this even, I'm a little reluctant to mention this because it could take us off on a tangent. I don't think it needs to happen this time, but this idea of the mountaintops being places of revelation, I think points us to a temple motif, since we know that mountains were God's first temples. And in fact, the Jerusalem temple is even called the mountain of the Lord's house, or simply the mountain house. There's that mountain temple connection, revelation. Temples are places of revelation. They've been described as the Lord's university. Well, for Moses on Mount Sinai and for Nephi on whatever mountain is being reflected in their journey. And you would know, I mean, you're the expert on parallels between the Israelite Exodus and other things, and other journeys. But the thing that I'm most impressed by is Nephi's actual use of the Exodus in his teachings to illustrate their own circumstances, starting in chapter 17 with verse 23. But let me just read, if you don't mind, verse 30 of, I'll read verse 23 and verse 30 of 1 Nephi chapter 17. Verse 23, "And it came to pass that I, Nephi, spake unto them, saying, Do ye believe that our fathers, who were the children of Israel, would have been led away out of the hands of the Egyptians if they had not hearkened unto the words of the Lord?" So Nephi is using ancient Israelite experience to address the problems with his brothers and the misbehavior that continues to dog them.
And he did that in 1 Nephi 3 and 4 as well, right? I mean, he's repeatedly seeing a parallel here.
And then, and it must be significant because there's a lot here, you know, that points to this parallel. Verse 30, "Notwithstanding they being led," meaning the Israelites, "the Lord their God, their Redeemer, going before them, leading them by day and giving light unto them by night, and doing all things for them which were expedient for man to receive, they hardened their hearts and blinded their minds and reviled against Moses and against the true and living God." Well, this is where this parallel becomes very personal for me, because I really believe that God leads me in ways that I would not have thought of on my own. He leads you. He leads all of us in these latter days. And we wouldn't have that help if we hardened our hearts and blinded our minds and reviled against the true and living God. So the parallel isn't just between the Exodus and Nephi's journey. It's also, it also involves us in a very important and real way. And one thing that intrigues me is in verses 25 through about, 29, Lehi says explicitly to Laman and Lemuel, "You know the things that I'm telling you are true." Verse 25, "Now you know," or "ye know." In fact, that phrase is used three times in that verse. Verse 26, "Now you know that Moses was commanded. You know that by his word, the waters of the Red Sea were parted." Verse 27, "But you know that the Egyptians were drowned." Verse 28, "And you know," ye know. So how did Laman and Lemuel know? Well, I think it's because as Israelites, they've been celebrating the Passover.
Yeah.
Year after year after year. And they had rehearsed this story their whole lives.
Yeah. This is a story they know better than any other.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. And I think that that has some application to us is the stories of faith that we read about in the scriptures, that we read about in the lives of other faithful Latter-day Saints, that we hear about in the lives of our progenitors, our ancestors, and even those that are contemporary with us are good to be repeated often.
Yes.
Because they help us to understand how this applies to us personally at times where we may not be able to see that.
Amen.
So I find this a pretty intriguing chapter for that reason.
And like you, I have to say that, I mean, there are plenty of things I have done in my life that were not my plan to do and they were a stretch for me. It's going beyond what I thought I was capable of. It's going beyond what I thought someone would want me to do. It was scary and hard, and often the road to start doing it was difficult. And it does remind me of what the Israelites are doing and what Nephi did. But the alternative is to have stayed in Egypt.
Yeah, well, exactly.
This may be tough, but it gets you into a good place eventually. It gets you to a great place. And the alternative is to stay in your old unhappy, or maybe you felt okay about it. Maybe it was comfortable because you'd become used to it, but it was bondage, right? I mean, that's our alternative. Stay in Egypt or be stretched by the Lord on difficult paths and come out somewhere fantastic.
And before we leave chapter 17, because we are taking a somewhat deeper dive into this than we might already do, significant doctrinal points come out of Nephi's teaching, his explication. And I'll just mention these as I see them. Number one, Nephi reminds his brothers that they know because they have been taught the Exodus motif. And we see that in those verses that we just talked about. We also come to understand that God's love is for all people, but that the fruits of God's love have limitations. This is 1 Nephi 17:35. The Lord esteemeth all flesh in one, but he that is righteous is favored of God. So it's not a question of whether or not God loves us. It's a question of whether we will respond to that love by doing the things that he asks us. And God does show favoritism, but it's favoritism based on our willingness to exercise our faith and keep the commandments. I think that that's a tremendously important passage, 1 Nephi 17:35. Yes.
And if, keep going.
No, God loves everybody, but he cannot do for those that don't keep his commandments what he can and will do for those that heed his word.
Absolutely.
A law.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think maybe that's expanded upon in verse 40, and maybe we can explore that just a little bit, where it says, "And he loveth those who will have him to be their God." Now, have him to be their God is a covenantal phrase. So you should recognize right away that basically he's saying he loves those who will covenant with him. But in case it's not clear enough, he goes on to say, "Behold, He loved our fathers, and he covenanted with them, yea, even Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, and he remembered the covenants which he had made. Wherefore, there's that word again, he did bring them out of the land of Egypt. So it seems to me, as you said already, it's clear God loves all of his children. There's no doubt he loves all of his children. But there's a special kind of love for those who have entered into a covenant relationship. So we can't tell because we only have the English text of this. That's our earliest version of this. But my guess would be in verse 40, where it talks about he loveth those and he loved our fathers, that the word is chesed. I would guess it's that special kind of mercy and love that's available only inside a covenant. Just based on the context, that would be my guess. I can't know. But we know there is a special kind of love, a special kind of bond, a special kind of mercy that is given to those who will enter into a covenant relationship with God. And as I've talked about elsewhere, I mean, that's natural in the same way that my wife loves everyone, but because of the nature of our covenant relationship and the shared strivings that that has given us because of that covenant, there's a special love that's not available outside of a context like that. It's only possible within a context like that. And I think that's part of what Nephi is trying to say here. And that ties in with what you're talking about with keeping the commandments, because that's what you do when you're in a covenant with God. Your obligation is to keep the commandments and love God. And so I think that's part of what Nephi is trying to teach us here, is get in this covenant, keep that covenant, and enjoy the love that God will give you and the place that that will take you.
Yeah. And you mentioned we don't have the original language behind the English of verse 40, but what we do have is we have a confirming concept from the Savior during that last night that he was with his apostles after the Last Supper, where he talks a lot about love. Chapters 14 and 15 of John, which, by the way, we don't find anywhere else. And then he says something really interesting. He says, ye are my friends if ye do whatsoever I command you.
Mm-hmm.
There's that if clause. And to me, that means that, yes, God's love is universal for his children. He's the grandparent of the universe. But we don't decide, based on our narrow perspective, God's friendship. That's reserved for him to decide based on whether or not we keep his commandments. So,
and that's that closer relationship again. When he talks about friendship, it's that relationship that covenant is all about.
It's the covenant relationship. You promise to do what he asks. And the result of that is, yes, you've always had his love, but now you have this closer relationship. You become his friend. And I'm pontificating here. I'll get off my high horse in a minute, but I get a little bit nervous once in a while when I hear people say, well, yeah, Jesus is my friend. And I know some things about the people that, you know, would raise an eyebrow. And I think, yes, I agree that he loves everyone. He loves all of us. But the friendship comes as a result of keeping the covenants that you made. You are my friends if you do whatsoever I ask of you. And I apologize if I sound too, uppity about that. But I think it's a true principle, honestly.
Yeah, I think that we're touching on something that is really important here. And I've heard, in ecclesiastical positions that I have been in or am in, and in our educational positions we've been in, I've heard the brethren, with a capital B, kind of wrestling with this idea of saying, okay, we want to teach everyone that God does love everyone, but we also need people to understand that doesn't mean you can do whatever you want, that there's an approval, there's an element of this that is conditional upon your obedience. And there's always this tension of how to work that out. And I think actually chesed is the solution to that. It is God's solution to that. It's this idea, I love everybody, but if you want into this higher relationship, this higher love, this greater amount of mercy, this greater bond, that only happens in one way. And so you can have an unconditional love that doesn't bring you into relationship with me and doesn't bring you blessings and doesn't bring us closer. I'll love you, but we're going to be at arm's length, as it were. And I'm going to be, that arm is going to be beckoning you, trying to pull you in, but it's going to be a certain distance. If you want to take the step into chesed, into that kind of love, that is conditional upon making and keeping covenants.
Not because God
doesn't want us to be there. He's desperate for us to be there, but we have to make that choice because it's impossible to have that relationship without doing it that way.
He can't do it for us.
Yeah.
Which is, before we leave chapter 17, I think it's interesting to note verse 45, which we have mentioned before, ye are swift to do iniquity. That, again, this is directed towards his older brothers and towards, I think, the posterity of Ishmael that have been influenced by them. You're swift to do iniquity, but slow to remember the Lord your God. Ye have seen an angel, and he spake unto you. Yea, ye have heard his voice from time to time, and he hath spoken unto you in a still small voice, but ye were past feeling. That important phrase, ye were past feeling and could not feel his words. Wherefore he has spoken unto you like unto the voice of thunder, and so on and so forth. So an interesting and important doctrinal point is taught here is that revelation comes many times through feelings, as President Packer used to say. And now we see these boys, these older sons that are past feeling, and that strain will continue all the way through Nephite society until we get to Moroni, chapter 9, verse 20. And what we learn there is that this concept of being past feeling leads not only to the destruction of an entire nation, but the end of a dispensation, frankly. And so it starts here, and then we can trace this all the way through till the end of the Book of Mormon, past feeling, how important it is to listen and to feel the communication that God is sending to each one of us. That's the nature of revelation. And I think that the Book of Mormon is a prime example of how that, you know, how that traces through the entire Nephite civilization. And of course, there's the concept that God does send wake-up calls, and we read that in chapter 17. Nephi is going to be bound with cords again a second time, and the Lord will send a pretty powerful message to the older sons. The chapter 18 of 1 Nephi concludes with the journey to the promised land and the arrival in the promised land. And Nephi records in 1 Nephi 19 that the Lord has commanded him to make a set of plates. And these were the large plates upon which the genealogy, his ancestors, the family activities in the wilderness are recorded. And then it's 20 or 30 years later that God commands Nephi to make another set of plates. These are the small plates that are mentioned in 2 Nephi, chapter 5, verse 30. And we're told that these contain events of Nephi's ministry and the prophecies and the sacred truths that be used to for a wise purpose. But there is this interesting concept, this interesting idea that in chapter 19, verse 6, that I think is worth mentioning. Even though what we've said about the large plates and the small plates is true, this is the underlying principle for both. Chapter 19, verse 6, nevertheless, I do not write anything upon plates, save it be that which I think is sacred. And so, you know, sometimes we tend to, you know, say, well, the large plates are not as important, or they're not as spiritual, or they're not as sacred as the small plates. And Nephi is saying, look, I don't put anything on plates, any of the plates that isn't pretty important, pretty spiritual, yeah, pretty sacred.
And I think it's worth stopping to think about, because, you know, we could hear that and say, well, I mean, it was a waste of time then for him to write on those because we don't have them. But let's remember that the Nephites for 1,000 years did have them. that it guided and influenced Nephites for a very long time. And Nephi's teachings are foundational for Nephite religious history. They get referred to a long time. And I think they had the large plates more than they had the small plates. Mormon seems to be surprised when he finds the small plates. Oh, look at these. These are cool. But yeah, what they primarily were using was the large plates. So we may not have that record of the large plates. Joseph Smith read them, and that was probably also important for him and his learning what he needed to know. But the Nephites had them, and my guess is we're getting hints and reflections of them through Alma's teachings and Helaman's teachings and so on and so on.
Yeah, and pardon this insertion of historical comments here in this last dispensation, but if you read some of these accounts by Brother Brigham, President Young, and others, there were a lot of plates that existed. It isn't just the gold plates,
right,
which I think is an important concept to keep in mind. There were lots of records, and we're so blessed to have a genius prophet, prophets, Mormon and Moroni, to condense it down into the Book of Mormon record that we have now. Give us the best, the most important. Well, the end of chapter 19, or towards the end of chapter 19, is this principle that we've mentioned before, where Nephi again is trying to teach his recalcitrant brothers, and he is reading to them from the Pentateuch, from the books of Moses, first five books of Moses, but then he makes this comment, which leads to chapters 20, 21, and his divine interpretation or spiritual interpretation in chapter 22. This is what he says. This is 1 Nephi 19:23. I did read many things unto them which were written in the books of Moses, but that I might more fully persuade them to believe in the Lord their Redeemer, I did read unto them that which was written by the prophet Isaiah, for I did liken all scriptures unto us, that it might be for our profit and for our learning. And so what we get then in chapters 20 and 21 is Nephi turning to Isaiah chapters 48 and 49 to teach several important lessons: the coming of the Messiah, the power of the Messiah to restore and to redeem. And that's not just from sin, sorrow, and suffering, but we're talking about physical restoration as well, physical redemption. And then in chapter 21, as we have been reading, we see that Isaiah he's been talking about servants who would help the Israelites in the gathering process, in the redemptive process. And in chapter 21, he announces a special servant who would come forward in a future time, i.e. the latter days, and possess several attributes, several qualities, unmistakable qualities that would bless Israel in the last days with the completion of the gathering. And so let me just quickly, if I can, list the qualities, the attributes that Isaiah announces in chapter 49 or in 1 Nephi chapter 21. So you'll recognize these characteristics or qualities, I think, as soon as we pull them out of the different verses. So this servant whom Isaiah sees in a future day, in the latter days, would be someone who, verse 1, the Lord has called from the womb. This is 1 Nephi 21:1 or 49:1. This special servant would be someone whose mouth was like a sharp sword, verse 2 of 1 Nephi 21, or someone who spoke with authority, in other words. This special servant would be hidden in the shadow of the Lord's hand. a special servant who was made a polished shaft in his quiver, whom the Lord has hidden. Someone who would say, quote, I have labored in vain, unquote. That's verse 4. Someone who would authoritatively say, and now saith the Lord. That's verse 5 of Nephi 21. Someone who would say that the Lord hath, quote, formed me from the womb to do a special work, or someone who was foreordained. This servant's life's work would be to, quote, bring Jacob again to the Lord, though Israel be not gathered. That's verse 5. Verse 6, someone who would be the Lord's, quote, servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the preserved of Israel, unquote. Someone who the Lord would give for a light unto the Gentiles, that's verse 6. Someone whom man despiseth, verse 7. Someone who would be given to Israel, quote, for a covenant of the people to establish the earth, to cause to inherit the desolate heritages, who would free prisoners and enlighten those who sit in darkness. So this chapter that Nephi reads to his brothers really is a chapter for us.
Yeah.
Because all in one way or another, I think these various characteristics could refer to a lot of different special servants that the Lord has raised up over the centuries and millennia. But taken all together, I think there's only two people that fit all of these characteristics listed in chapter 49 or in 1 Nephi 21. One of them is obviously Jesus Christ, and the other one is the prophet Joseph Smith. And when we look at all of these characteristics, we realize that, in fact, Joseph Smith fits the bill in every case. He was called from the womb. He knew that he had been chosen as the prophet of the restoration. He spoke with a sharp sword. That is to say, he spoke the word of the Lord. You know, we read in the Doctrine and Covenants several passages that use the phrase sharper than a two-edged sword. He was hid by the Lord, according to section 86, verse 9. He became a polished shaft in the quiver of the Almighty. Joseph Smith himself said, I am like a huge rough stone rolling down from a high mountain. We know that Joseph Smith at times became discouraged and felt that his labors were in vain. Look at section 121, verse 2. Only Joseph had the authority to speak for God, and so on and so on and so on. So the sort of the high point for me, as Nephi says, I'm reading Isaiah to help my brothers understand and also to hope for their repentance. The high point is, in the last days, God's going to provide this servant, and it's none other than the prophet Joseph Smith. So that is the high point of the Isaianic passages, is ultimately pointing to our own day and this great servant who has done more for the salvation of the children of men on earth than any other person, except for the Messiah, who also fulfills all of the qualities and characteristics.
So amen. Amen to that. And I mean, to see Christ and Joseph Smith in here, I think, is so powerful. And maybe I'll throw one other way of likening this to ourselves in there, if that's all right, because I mean, first of all, I don't want to take away, I couldn't agree more emphatically. The most important fulfillments of this are Christ and then Joseph Smith. But I think there's another thing that it's important for us to look at. Excuse me, hang on just a second. Okay. If we look at verse 3, this is one of there are a few places where the servant is identified in Isaiah, and one of them is chapter 49, verse 3, or 1 Nephi 21, verse 3. Thou art my servant, O Israel. Now, let's keep that in mind, and let's go back to 1 Nephi 19, as you were talking about, where I think so wonderful all of the ways we likened it, and all of those are intended. But if we were to look in verse 19, we could start like maybe in verse 10, where Nephi starts to talk about the God of our fathers who were led out of Egypt. So we get that again. And then he talks about Christ. But then he starts to turn that into talking about those who are at Jerusalem and God remembering his covenants to the covenant people. And so on. And so he talks about covenant people. Then we get verse 23, as you said, I did read many things unto them, which were written in the books of Moses, that I might more fully persuade them to believe in the Lord, their Redeemer. So there's that part you've already talked about. Christ is the focus of this. He says, I did read unto them that which was written by the prophet Isaiah, for I did liken all scriptures unto us, that it might be for our profit and learning. Wherefore, there's one of those words again, because I want this to be likened unto them for their profit and learning. I spake unto them, saying, hear ye the words of the prophet, ye who are a remnant of the house of Israel, a branch who have been broken off. Hear ye the words of the prophet, which were written unto all the house of Israel, and liken them unto yourselves, that ye may have hope as well as your brethren from whom ye have been broken off. Now, it seems to me the context before verse 23 is all about the house of Israel. Verse 24 makes it very clear it's about the house of Israel. Then we're going to read these prophecies about this, the gathering of the house of Israel, including the verse that says, the servant is the house of Israel. I think that the primary likening that's happening, or that Nephi is talking about, is for us to recognize Isaiah is talking about the house of Israel. It's talking about the covenant with God and Christ being the fulfillment of that covenant with the house of Israel. But he's talking about that covenant with Israel. So he says to his brothers, you're of the house of Israel. So what Isaiah is writing is about you. And he is saying that to us as well. You're covenant people. Andrew Skinner is, Carrie Mielstein is, so is everyone who is listening that has made a covenant with God. You are covenant people. Therefore, these prophecies, Isaiah 48 and 49, I'm going to read to you, but really everything that he's writing and everything that is in the scriptures, but these prophecies very specifically are about you, house of Israel. And so if we're going to liken it in that way and then go to 49 verse 3 or 21 verse 3 and remember that Israel is God's servant, then in some ways these chapters have to be about us as well. We have to find how they're telling us we need to go and do these things. So, for example, if we're to go back to Isaiah 49 or 1 Nephi 21, after he talks about all these things you've talked about, and then we get verse 6, and he said, it is a light thing. And that one is, it's not a very heavy thing. It's too easy of a thing that thou should be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the preserved of Israel. I will also give thee for a light. And that's the optical light to the Gentiles, that thou mayest be my salvation unto the ends of the earth. That's absolutely true about Christ. That is absolutely true about Joseph Smith, but it needs to be true about me and about you as well, that God is saying, it's too small a thing for you to just try and save the people around you, you know, the people in your ward. You need to bring my gospel to the whole world. That's your role as a covenant people. And so I think that's one of the ways that Nephi is intending for us to liken this. He intended for Laman and Lemuel, but also intending for us to liken this to ourselves. And so I think primary interpretation, Jesus Christ, probably next primary interpretation, Joseph Smith. But a very important interpretation is Andrew Skinner and Carrie Mielstein and Wayne Chapel and whoever else, Rich Nichols, whoever else we want to throw in there, any names you can come up with, John Smith, that we can say these are about us as a covenant person as well.
Well said. I would be remiss if I didn't mention that the last chapter of our section, chapter 22, Isaiah reveals events associated with the restoration and redemption.
Or Nephi Israel. Does, do you mean? Or
what did I say? Isaiah?
Isaiah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. It's Nephi, inspired prophetic commentary on everything that's been said beforehand. Yeah. And it's a very powerful chapter that ties in with the latter days, and mentioning that that a mighty nation will be raised up. It's the phrase, this land upon which the mighty nation will be established, and this idea of a marvelous work that the Lord will proceed to do among the Gentiles. So the Gentiles actually are front and center and focus of 1 Nephi chapter 22. And and maybe the best thing that I can do is just read in conclusion just a couple of verses from 1 Nephi chapter 22.
Mm-hmm.
Because it sort of solidifies and brings together what we've been saying. This is 1 Nephi 22, 8, 9, and 12, more or less, a few little ellipses here. Quote.
And maybe before you read that, Mick, because I want you to be able to end just reading these verses the way you want. So maybe I'll just say this now. I think it's important for us to recognize that often he's talking about Gentile nations, right? So
yeah.
In a way, we would all be in Gentile nations, although we're Israelite individuals within those Gentile nations. And I think it's important to remember that distinction sometimes.
So let me read this passage, and then I'll conclude with a comment by Marky Peterson, who was a member of the Quorum of the 12 Apostles years and years ago, who wrote a fantastic book called The Great Prologue, in which he ties together the redemption and restoration and gathering of Israel with the establishment of the American nation on which we live. Quote, 1 Nephi 22, "And after our seed is scattered, the Lord God will proceed to do a marvelous work among the Gentiles, which shall be of great worth unto our seed. Wherefore it is likened unto their being nourished by the Gentiles and being carried in their arms and upon their shoulders. And it shall also be of worth unto the Gentiles, and not only unto the Gentiles, but unto all the house of Israel, unto the making known of the covenants of the Father of heaven unto Abraham, saying, in that in thy seed shall all kindreds of the earth be blessed. Wherefore he will bring them again out of captivity. They shall be gathered together to the lands of their inheritance. They shall be brought out of obscurity and of darkness, and they shall know that the Lord is their Savior and their Redeemer, the Mighty One of Israel." And this really pertains to, as you so nicely summarize, this really pertains to all of us. Elder Marky Peterson talked about who these Gentiles are that Nephi refers to, and this is the quote that I'll end with. He says, quote, we are referred to in this prophecy as Gentiles, but we are the believing Gentiles because we have the believing blood of Ephraim in our veins as well mm-hmm. as the blood of the Gentiles. Our pedigrees show that we come from many nationalities. In the revealed dedicatory prayer for the Kirtland Temple, the prophet Joseph Smith used this expression, quote, concerning the revelations and commandments which thou hast given us, who are identified with the Gentiles. That's section 109, verse 60. It is inspiring indeed to realize that we who live now and have received the restored gospel are the very ones to whom Nephi and the Christ referred to some 2,000 years ago. We have lived in prophecy. Well, that's really kind of a way of saying that what you said regarding all of this pertaining to us, as well as to the Nephites and the Lehites and, you know, all the whole house of Israel, we're part of all of what Nephi had in mind when he read to them Isaiah. And I'm grateful to have that information that we can't find anywhere else in Scripture, only in the Book of Mormon.
Amen. Amen. This has been so much fun, Andy. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Maybe I'll just let our audience know what's coming up for them. We've got, as we mentioned earlier, Kent Brown will also talk a little bit about the trail and the journey in the wilderness. And also, I mean, we're not going to be able to touch on Isaiah very much, and that's painful for me. We've done it a little bit here. Besides the Isaiah stuff I've written, I know you've written a great article and another useful book. Andy, would you be willing to share with us that title?
You bet. The book is called Isaiah in the Book of Mormon, edited by Professor Welch and Professor Perry. My article is entitled Nephi's Lessons to His People, the Messiah, the Land, and Isaiah 48 to 49 in 1 Nephi 19 to 22. And some of the material that we talked about today, in fact, much of the material and a lot more can be found in that article.
Wonderful. And you can find that at BYU Scholars Archive, I know. So if you just Google either that title, I think it'll take you to BYU Scholars Archive, or if you, whatever search engine you use, you don't have to use Google. Or you can just go to BYU Scholars Archive and search for that title and you'll find it. So wonderful stuff. Thank you.
Thank you.
I've got Natalie Hunsaker, who's an artist that's been trying to depict things of from Isaiah and kind of her journey in understanding Isaiah 48 and 49. And she and I get jump into depth on that there. So she'll be on. And then I'll try and do a few extra things on my website, Enlighten EduU. But I guess in the end, I'll just say, if you want more on these Isaiah chapters, I'd refer you to my book, Learning to Love Isaiah. And I have Book of Mormon highlights in there trying to show a little bit of what Nephi is doing with Isaiah there. So you can get more into depth with it there. But that's about as much as we're going to be able to do. Next week, we're going to have Casey Griffiths on, and Lamar and I will also talk about the readings for next week. It's these powerful chapters, 2 Nephi 1 and 2, some of the more powerful, densely doctrinal, rich chapters in the Book of Mormon. So we'll invite our audience to come back next week and listen to that. And we hope that you'll share this with people. You know, these I love all the podcasts that I listen to, and I listen to a bunch, but I think that these kind of deeper dives that we're doing, you're not getting this anywhere else. And so all of it, we don't want to, we want to do both the things everyone else is doing and this. So let's do it all. I'm not disparaging others. I'm just saying we add a little variety. So share that with someone, let them know about the cool things that are going on here. Talk to them about it, share it electronically, like, download, rate, review, all those things. And remember that I've been asked to invite my audience to have a dialogue with us, share some of your insights with us. So please either email me at thescripturesareal@gmail.com or get on the YouTube channel where you can do it, or get on Enlightened EduU. That's we'll put the link on there. These are forums we're trying to create where you can leave your insights, and then we'll try and share those insights online from time to time and things like that. But we hope that you'll do that, because that's a valuable part of the Come Follow Me program, and we've been asked by those who run that program to invite you to do that with us. So please do that and share this with everyone, and we hope you'll have a wonderful day. And again, thank you so much, my good friend. You've edified me today. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. Pleasure to be with you.